From eternity past, God writes his story across the heavens, and in our deepening darkness, a light shines. And in one incredible moment, our God became a man. The one who existed before all things came to us as a helpless child. Today, more than 2,000 years later, the miraculous circumstances of Christ's birth still astound us. Yet everything from that night reminds us of the wonder of the child himself. In one incredible moment, God's perfect plan of salvation appeared in the flesh.
In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was made God, and the Word was God. The same was in the beginning.
The noise and the bustle began earlier than usual in the tiny town of Bethlehem. As night gave way to dawn, people were already on the streets. Augustus did the economy of Bethlehem a favor when he decreed a census should be taken. One's imagination is kindled, thinking about the conversation of the innkeeper and his wife at the breakfast table. Did anyone mention the arrival of the young couple the night before? Did anyone comment on the pregnancy of the girl on the donkey? No, it was doubtful that anyone mentioned the couple's arrival or the condition of the girl. They were too busy. There was bread to be made and morning chores. There was much too much to do to imagine that the impossible had occurred. God had entered the world as a baby.
Boy, they made you be born in a manger. Sweet little holy child, didn't know who you was, didn't know you'd come to save us, Lord, to take our sins away.
This isn't the way I planned it, God. Not at all. My child being born in a stable? This isn't the way I thought it would be. A cave with sheep and donkeys? Hay and straw? When you sent the angel and spoke of the son being born, this isn't what I pictured. Any minute now, Mary is going to give birth. Not to an infant, but to God. That's what the angel said. That's what Mary believes. And God, my God, that's what I want to believe. It seems so unbelievable, so incredible. I guess I shouldn't question you. Forgive my struggling. Trust doesn't come easy to me, God. But then you never said it would be easy, did you?
The sun just seems to disappear. And when he laughs, it shines again. How could it be? Father, show me where I fit into this plan of yours. How can a man be father to the Son of God? Lord, for all my life I've been a simple carpenter. How can I raise a king? How can I raise a king? How could it be? This baby in my arms, sleeping now so peacefully, the Son of God, the angel said, how could it be?
It had been an exhausting few days, but it was quiet now. The long trip to Bethlehem, the search for shelter, and the birth of the baby. Now, Mary was alone with her thoughts.
Sleep well, sweet Jesus. Who knows what's to come? I know there's a will and a purpose you must fulfill. Gabriel said so. But God, for now, can I just hold him and love him and keep him safe? He's just my little baby, flesh and blood in my arms. I love him so. Jehovah, help me to be a good mother to your son. Savior, it's just so much to take in. I don't understand, but I offer all I am for the sake of your plan. Help me to be strong, Lord. He's only a little child.
Yes.
There was one word that describes the night he came. Ordinary. An ordinary night with an ordinary sky. The sheep were ordinary. No fleece made of gold. No history makers or blue ribbon winners. They were simply sheep. Lumpy, sleeping silhouettes on a hillside. And the shepherds, probably wearing all the clothes they owned, smelling like sheep and looking just as woolly, they were nameless and simple. But suddenly, the night was ordinary no more.
When it comes around, it's the sound of an offering. When it hits the ground, it is bound to make nature sing. Glory to the King of Kings. Can you hear the flight of celestial laughter? Piercing through the night, you can hear it ring. Dancing with delight and forever after, in the living light of the King of Kings. Can you? Ground, it is bound to make nature sing. Glory to the King of Kings. Can you hear the flight of celestial laughter? Piercing through the night, you can hear it ring. Dancing with delight and forever after, in the living light of the King of Kings.
Do I remember? Like it just happened yesterday. Nothing like that had ever happened before that night, and nothing even close to that has happened since. Surely you recall that night.
Of course I do. I was as afraid as you were. In fact, when Caleb fell to his knees, I thought he died. Oh, I was so frightened, I could hardly move.
Suddenly, from out of nowhere, an angel of the Lord appeared before us and said, "Fear not, fear not." I was terrified, but what beautiful singing.
Imagine the glory of the Lord shining down around us. I shudder just remembering. How can you describe such an incredible moment?
Ever wonder why the announcement went first to the shepherds? They were men who didn't have a reputation to protect or an axe to grind or a ladder to climb. Men who didn't know enough to tell God that angels don't sing to sheep and that messiahs aren't found wrapped in rags and sleeping in a feeding trough. So while the theologians and the elite were busy elsewhere, the meek were kneeling. They were kneeling before the one. Only the meek will see. They were kneeling in front of Jesus. Now in Jerusalem, there was an upright and devout man named Simeon. God had revealed to him that he would not die until he had seen the Messiah. And now Simeon's one incredible moment occurs 8 days after the birth of Jesus.
There are so many people here. Yet I know Jehovah wants me here in the temple today. I have prayed for years that I might see the Messiah, and God told me I would.
Simeon is a man waiting with anticipation, eyes open, searching the crowd for the right face and hoping that face appears today.
There. No, that's not him. Where is he? I know he must be here.
In the end, the prayer of Simeon was answered. Simeon took the baby in his arms and thanked God.
Now, Lord, let me, your servant, die in peace, as you said, for my eyes have seen your salvation.
Waiting, longing, hoping for the day, I would look upon Messiah's face, knowing in my spirit that before my life was done, I'd behold Messiah, Emmanuel, God's Son. At last I see with my eyes, I touch him with my hands, I marvel in the presence of the great I am. Now my soul I know at rest, I reach out with joy to bless him, and I smile. I see him, this holy child. Loving, thanking, praising God on high, salvation's light. But I know great sorrow will be the price he pays, that we may find redemption, that we marvel in the presence of the great I am. Now my soul can be at rest, I reach out with joy.
Holy child.
Suppose you could give a gift to Christ. What would it be? How could you possibly select a gift for the one who not only has everything, but who made everything? When the wise men found him, more than gold, frankincense, and myrrh, they gave him the gifts of hope, time, and worship. Three gifts the wise still give.
The reason I have a funny last name, Bjork, is that I'm Scandinavian. My father was born in Sweden. My mother was a first-generation American Swede. And I was born in northern Minnesota. A Scandahoovian I therefore am through and through. In keeping with the joyful spirit of this Yuletide season, I'd like to share with you now two Scandinavian treats for the holidays. One is a Christmas carol, and the other is a literary gem. The Christmas carol is an ode to lutefisk, that stinky, slimy codfish that has ruined many a December holiday for countless numbers of Swedes, Norwegians, and Danes alike. The stirring song about it goes to the tune of O Tannenbaum. Listen now to some of its lilting lyrics. O lutefisk, O lutefisk, how fragrant thy aroma. O lutefisk, O lutefisk, you put me in a coma. You smell so strong, you look like glue. You taste just like a tennis shoe. But lutefisk, come Christmas Day, I think I'll eat you anyway. But wait, there's more. O lutefisk, O lutefisk, how well do I remember? On Christmas Eve, we'd all receive the big treat of December. It wasn't turkey or fried ham, it wasn't even pickled spam. My mother knew there was no risk, in serving buttered lutefisk. And incidentally, even though I am thoroughly Swedish, I have no intention of eating lutefisk on Christmas Day or any other day of the year for that matter, because it really does put me in a coma. The other Scandinavian treat for the holidays I want to pass on to you is a literary gem. It was written by the Norwegian author Sigrid Undset, whose assorted works of poetry and prose earned her the Nobel Prize for Literature in 1928. Here's her take on Christmas and what it means. And when we give each other gifts in his name, let us remember that he has given us the sun and the moon and the stars, and the earth with its forests and mountains and oceans, and all that lives and moves upon them. He has given us all green things, and everything that blossoms and bears fruit, and all that we quarrel about, and all that we have misused, and to save us from our own foolishness, from all our sins, he came down to earth and gave us himself. Yes, he did indeed come down to earth so that he might give us himself. In one incredible moment on that first Noel, our God became a man. A man known to history as Jesus of Nazareth. In Matthew's gospel, we read this account of how this happened 2 millennia ago. This is how Jesus the Messiah was born. His mother Mary was engaged to be married to Joseph. But before the marriage took place, while she was still a virgin, she became pregnant through the power of the Holy Spirit. Joseph, her fiancé, was a good man and did not want to disgrace her publicly, so he decided to break the engagement quietly. As he considered this, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream. "Joseph, son of David," the angel said, "do not be afraid to take Mary as your wife, for the child within her was conceived by the Holy Spirit, and she will have a son, and you are to name him Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins." All of this occurred to fulfill the Lord's message through his prophet. "Look, the virgin will conceive a child. She will give birth to a son, and they will call him Emmanuel, which means God is with us." Two big truths about Jesus stand out, at least to me, here in Matthew chapter 1. Number one would be his identity. He is nothing less than God wrapped in human flesh. They will call him Emmanuel, which means in Hebrew, God is with us. The Swiss psychiatrist Paul Tournier years ago reacted to that sentiment in this way. "The great gift, the unique and loving one, is not a thing, but a person. It is Jesus Christ himself. In him, God has given no longer just things, but his own person, his own suffering. This gift of all gifts is the self-commitment of God himself." Suppose John 3:16, the most familiar verse in the Bible, were worded differently. "For God so loved the world that he gave us an iPhone." "For God so loved the world that he gave us a townhouse." "For God so loved the world that he gave us a BMW. All of those are nice things. But somehow, Those versions don't pack the wallop of the original, do they? For God so loved the world that he gave us his one and only Son. For God so loved the world that he gave us himself. They shall call him Emmanuel, which means God is with us. The second big truth that emerges from Matthew 1 is his mission. He will save his people from their sins, from those roadblocks in who we are and what we do or do not do that keep us from God. Jesus' identity is God in the flesh. That is who he is. His mission is to save us from our sins. That is why he came. 2 Corinthians 5:19 pulls these two truths together in one magnificent thought. God was in Christ, making all mankind his friends. God did not keep an account of their sins, and he has given us the message which tells how he makes them his friends. I'm here tonight to pass a message on to you from God. I want to tell you how you can become a friend of God, how you can be a BFF with your Maker. Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, the babe of Bethlehem, the Lamb of God who went to the cross of Calvary, there to save you from your sins, and you shall be saved. You will become in that transaction a friend of God, a member of his forever family. And someday you will dwell with him forever in his heavenly home. In just a few weeks, the classic Yuletide cartoon, A Charlie Brown Christmas, will air on television nationwide for the 54th time. In that animated saga, a momentous scene unfolds. Charlie Brown's friend Linus proclaims to Charlie and others what Christmas is all about. He quotes from memory, Luke 2, verses 8 to 14, which recounts the birth of Christ the Lord. As he begins his recitation, Linus does something remarkable. He drops his security blanket. He gives up his most prized possession in this world, a cherished rag from which he is otherwise inseparable. What prompts Linus to do such an unthinkable thing? These words from Dr. Luke's record of the Nativity do. "Don't be afraid," the angel said. "I bring you good news that will bring great joy to all people. The Savior has been born today in Bethlehem, the city of David." Yes, in one incredible moment, God became man. And he became man to be our Savior, to save us from our sins. Through him, you and I can have life. We can have it more abundantly, and we can have it eternally. So let go of that earthly security blanket of yours, my friend, and do not be afraid, for God is with us.
Thank you.
Can anything separate us from the love Christ has for us? God answered our question before we asked it. So we'd see his answer, he lit the sky with a star. So we'd hear it, he filled the night with a choir. And so we'd believe it, he did what no man had ever dreamed. He became flesh and dwelt among us. He placed his hand on the shoulder of humanity and said, "You're something special." What an incredible moment.
Her king, that little baby is a king. Christmas, everyone. Let's thank this sanctuary choir of Grace Bible Church. What a great job tonight.